My name is Nithya Narasimhan. I'm a senior cloud advocate at Microsoft. And today, I want to talk to you about JavaScript Object Notation, or JSON. Let's get started. To set some context for why you need JSON, let's first think about JavaScript objects. Here, we have a very simple example of a JavaScript object. And if I were to just print that out and look at its type, you can see it's an object with two properties, title and author. And when I actually print it out to the console, you can see that title is the name and the value 1984 and George Orwell are strings. Great, nothing new there. Now let's think about collections of objects. It's actually very similar. So if I were to do this again, now we can see that by printing out the contents of an object collection, in this case an array, that really is an array of objects, each of which is a name value, a collection of name value pairs. All of them have the same properties, they just have different values. Simple. Here comes the issue. Let's say you actually want to use this data for some kind of a request you need to make over the network. Maybe there's a library API that you need to hit, and this is the data you need to give it to let the library know that the users checked out these books. Or you might want to store it to your file system. Turns out that many of these file transfer and communication protocols require request response messages to be in text format. So we need some way to take this data from JavaScript and convert it into strings or text format that can be used in messaging over the network or in transfers to a file system. This is where JSON comes in. And you're very lucky because JSON just has two methods you need to know. The first one is called Stringify. Let's take a look at what that does and then we'll talk a little bit about it. So in this, book.json is effectively giving you the result of json.stringify called on the book object, right? So in effect, json.stringify is a method that takes an object and returns back a stringified form of it. And you can check, like when you look at the type of book.json, it's a string. And when you print it out, you can see that it's effectively nothing more than a list of name value pairs, but both names and values are stringified. So effectively, this is in complete text readable format. And guess what? I don't even need a different method API or method call if I'm using an array. It's the exact same format. So let's try this out. I just call json.stringify on the mybooks object, which is effectively an array of or a collection of book objects. And voila, I have a stringified flattened format of the contents of that array. And you can see in here that the stringified format effectively represents the array and then the individual objects in the array separated by commas, just as you would expect. The most important thing about JSON is you can see it's user readable. You can look at this, and even if you didn't know anything about the program, you could understand that this is a collection of books. So this is great. You were able to now take JavaScript objects or collections of objects and flatten them into a single string that contains all the data in those objects. But what if you wanted to do the reverse? Like once you've got it in JSON, how do you get the objects back? That's why you need to know method number two. And that is called json.parse. Let's take a look at what that does. So in this case, all I've done is I've taken the string that we got in the previous method when we stringified an object, taken that string, and you know, you could have gotten a JSON string from anywhere, and given it to the json.parse method, and then inspect whatever it is that we get back as a result. So in this case, first of all, let's log what we get back as a result, and you can immediately see that you get back the exact object that we had parsed for book, right? So it's title, author, and the values for those two properties. Second, I did a call to see, you know, array is array parsed, which is effectively checking to see if this returned object is an array, and it's not, which makes sense because it's a single object. Third, I looked at how many items were in there. And since this isn't an array, this is undefined. So perfect. Why did I do all this? Because guess what? The one thing about json.parse is you don't need to know the string coming in. You don't need to know ahead of time whether it comes from a stringified form of an object or a stringified form of a collection. It's going to be the exact same call. So let's try this out with the array. In this case, what we're doing is we're parsing mybooks.json, which if you remember was obtained by stringifying a collection. So effectively, it's a string that represents a collection of objects. Just pass it to the exact same method. And now, when we call these methods, let me scroll this up so you can see all the data. When we actually call this, you can see that the data that it returns is in fact the array of objects that was serialized in the first place. When you do an array is array, you see that it comes out to be true. The number of items tells you that there are four. In effect, that string that you had has now been deserialized back into an array of objects that you can now work with in JavaScript. And this is all you need to know. JSON.stringify to convert objects into JSON strings, whether they be single objects or collections. And JSON.parse to now take that stringified format and revert it back into either an object or an array based on what you were packing in the first place. I'll just leave you with one final thought. This is just looking at very simple objects. You should play with a little bit more in terms of examples. But let's say you wanted to take data from an object that had both properties and functions. You could still serialize it to JSON, which would serialize the data, and then revert it back into the object. At that point, you could have written object constructors that let you take JSON data and reinstate the object with the additional functions and everything defined in there and only the data initialized. That's all I had to say about JSON, and I hope this was interesting. Look out for the next demo video. See ya.